lasagna or that to the tipper, so we can do it again.
Yeah. Provide publicity and bring food to sustain the quilters together.
We celebrate generosity. We give thanks for the fellowship of all who work together to make the quilts, the laughter, the shared stories, the joy of crafting something with one's hands and heart for another, and the time to reflect and wonder about the recipient. We celebrate community. We send these quilts as a sign of God's love and blessing for each person who receives one, trusting that their quilt will be a source of comfort and hope in the midst of disaster and fear. A symbol of Christ's love to those who suffer, a reminder that each recipient is a beloved child of God. We celebrate hope in the midst of life's trials. We remember those who have received our quilts in the past and pray that their lives have returned to stability. We celebrate the gift of life. We ask that you bless the fruits of our labor and the whole mission of the peacemakers, that together we may minister to our neighbors in need. Bless all who give and all who receive, as we are sown together in the unity of your Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. Okay, who hasn't, question. Oh yeah, who hasn't lit one a candle yet in the group? Kaylee, you haven't lit a candle yet? You both have lit one in the past? Both? Okay. Well, let's start with Kaylee. Now let's start with Damien. You were one of the first ones, right? We'll have you light the one low, and then you can go around the back to get the blue one in the back. This one here. I brought some wipes to wipe off the handle this week. Let me pass it. Okay. So let's see, Damien, come first. Rather than get the light from there, I'll have it just move this up to where the wick sticks out a little. Well, not quite that far. Up there. Okay. Oops, sorry. You get the first one if you can reach it. Okay. Oh, I was going to say leave it lit, but because we got a second one coming. Go ahead, listen. I'll have you take a light from there and go around the back. And then I think, Zuri, would you be next in line again? Or is it Eric or Ian? Remember how the order went. Let's do Ian for the third. Ian, you get a unique one. Can you guess which one you get? The pink one, exactly. Anybody know why it's pink? It's what? Joy, very good. You've been studying here, I can tell, Damien, is there any? Yes, the third Sunday of Advent used to be called Gaudete Sunday. Gaudete is a word that means joy. And when you hear the lessons, you'll hear the joy expressed. Okay, thank you. Let's see. Now we get to stay and read one more blessing on the screen. Go ahead and get your eyes up there as we read with the congregation. We praise you, O God, for this victory wreath that marks our days of preparation for Christ's advent. As we light the candles on this wreath, strengthen our hearts as we await the Lord's coming in glory. Enlighten us with your grace that we may serve our neighbors in need. Grant this through Christ our Lord, whose coming is certain and whose day draws near. Amen. Okay, some of you are going to Sunday school now. And I know Eric is going to read our lessons today and then go to Sunday school. So, Eric, if you go ahead and get in your place where you read, unless you guys want to hear him read, you want to hear him read before you go to Sunday school? Okay, join your parents, and then we'll send you out with Tonya and Dawn after that.
Dawn Chesterford?
You what?
Dawn Chesterford?
You're going to read Isaiah.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, tell him. Go ahead and remove your mask though, so we can hear you better.
The Spirit of the Lord,
we can hear him, right?
God, is upon me. Because the Lord has anointed me, he has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and to release the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, and a day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion. a garland instead of ashes. Give them the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They will be called the oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, to display his glory. They shall build up the ancient ruins, they shall rise up the former devastations, they shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. For I, the Lord, love justice, I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully give them their recompression, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants shall be known among the nations, and their offspring shall be known among the people. And all who see them shall acknowledge that they are people whom the Lord has blessed. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exult in my God, for he has clothed me in the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness. He has a bridegroom decked himself with a garland, and as a bride who adores herself with jewels. Who, for as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as the garden causes what sown in it to spring up, to the Lord will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all nations.
If you can read off the screen, can you see it in the back too? Your eyes, can you see it on the back wall?
Yes.
Okay, you read the P and we read the C's.
Okay. Paul, Psalm 126, New Revised Standard Version. When the Lord restores the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dream.
Then our mouth was filled with laughter, and our tongue with shouts of joy. Then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them.
The Lord has done great things for us, and we rejoiced. We rejoiced. Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like the watercourses in Nectope.
May those who sow in tears reap with shouts of joy.
Those who go out weeping, bearing seeds to the sowing, shall come home with shouts of joy, carrying the sheaves. The Holy Gospel according to the Saint John, the first chapter.
Okay, you'll be able to come on now and go to Sunday school. Very good. When he volunteered to read last week or whatever it was, I said, this is really a long, long Old Testament lesson. He wasn't deterred at all.
He did it,
and he did it well. Thank you so much. He does need help with one area, though. I have to raise him up a little. So if I stand up there, I'll be about 8 foot tall if I don't move that for you. Let us rise for the gospel lesson. Holy Gospel according to St. John, the first chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. This is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but confessed, "I'm not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness. Make straight the way of the Lord, as the prophet Isaiah said. Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet? John answered them, I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal. This took place in Bethany across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Grace and peace to each of you from Christ Jesus our Lord and our Savior. Today is the third Sunday of Advent. The pink candle of joy has been lit. Today, like Isaiah and John the Baptist, we rejoice and give testimony or witness to the light, the true light coming into the world, Jesus himself. In our Old Testament lesson from Isaiah, though the people of Israel had returned from exile in Babylon, they continued to face hardship and oppression. In the language of the Jubilee year described in Leviticus 25, the prophet, moved by the Spirit of God, announces deliverance for those who are oppressed and comfort for those who mourn. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn. The year of the Lord's favor is best understood as a reference to either the coming of a sabbatical year or the year of Jubilee. In the former, the sabbatical or seventh year was a time when slaves were freed and debts were canceled. The Jubilee, the 50th year in a cycle, was the time again when slaves were freed, debts canceled, but also land holdings were redistributed to their original owners. At any rate, both were years of God's favor, when human misfortune was reversed and a new beginning proclaimed and realized. For those who benefited, either was a year of release, but to those who have subjected others, it was a day of divine vengeance. For those who benefited, the prophet says, I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exult in my God. For he has clothed me with garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness. The robe of righteousness reminds one of the African-American spiritual, all God's children got a robe. The American slaves long for the day of freedom and release, and wearing that new robe similar to our baptismal garment. And that release was a promise that could be counted on for Israel and for American slaves. For as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as the garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all the nations. Joy is repeated in our psalmody for today because of the great things God has done for Israel, especially restoring them from exile. There the psalmist says, when the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dreamed. Then our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongue with shouts of joy. Then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we rejoice. In the gospel, we are following up on John the Baptist, but this time not from the gospel of Mark, but rather the gospel of John. There, John the Baptist comes as a witness to testify to the light who is Christ. John's testimony was that he is not the Messiah or Elijah or the prophet, but the one preparing the way of the Lord, calling people to repentance for the forgiveness of sins, and baptizing them with water. This salvation, this forgiveness, brings joy as well. Here John displays incredible humility in making himself lower than Jesus. He says, "I'm not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." It reminds me of another John, Senator John McCain. When asked to demonize his then-competitor Barack Obama as a Muslim and non-citizen of the United States, instead of taking the bait and thinking of his own need to win the presidency, Senator McCain took the high road of truth and humility. He lifted up Obama as a family man, as a Christian, and as someone born in this country. I miss those days of humility and honesty in our highest offices of power. Another analogy to John as a forerunner of the Christ is as a pace setter in a race. The pace setter goes out early and sets a fast clip for the other runners to help them maintain a certain pace. Then, after sacrificing his own standing and falling back because he's out of energy, the pace setter falls back in the race and allows the star runners to shine. Such was John. He goes ahead of Jesus, sets the pace on calls to repentance and change, and then falls back and allows Jesus to take the lead. John directs attention away from himself to Jesus, the light of the world. The light which shines justice, peace, and mercy into that same world. Like John, we too are witnesses to the light and call ourselves and others to repentance in order to make a straight path for our Lord. One possible sermon hymn that we could have used today, especially if traditional, was "Christ Be Our Light." The lyrics are very appropriate. Longing for light, we wait in darkness. Longing for truth, we turn to you. Make us your own, your holy people, light for the world to see. Longing for peace, our world is troubled. Longing for hope, many despair. Your word alone has power to save us. Make us your living voice. Longing for food, many are hungry. Longing for water, many still thirst. Make us your bread, broken for others, shared until all are fed. Longing for shelter, many are homeless. Longing for warmth, many are cold. Make us your building, sheltering others, walls made of living stone. The refrain would have been sung between each verse. Christ be our light, shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ be our light, shine in your church, gather today. I wrap up with a couple examples of being light and calling ourselves to repentance. So many have suffered from the effects of the coronavirus, including death and other losses, not just here, but all over the world. The United Nations and World Health Organization leaders have put out this call to be light in the world for these suffering populations. Some of their commentary. The coronavirus pandemic, the measures taken by countries to try to stop its spread, and the economic impact have fueled a 40% increase in the number of people needing humanitarian help. 2021 is literally going to be a catastrophic based on what we're seeing at this stage of the game. For a dozen countries, famine is knocking on the door. 2021 is likely to be the worst humanitarian crisis year since the beginning of the United Nations 75 years ago. And we're not going to be able to fund everything. So we have to prioritize the icebergs in front of the Titanic. The two groups are calling for vaccines to be made available to all, and for rich countries to help developing countries combat and recover from the pandemic. To quote one of those leaders, he said, "We simply cannot accept a world in which the poor and marginalized are trampled by the rich and powerful in the stampede for vaccines. This is a global crisis, and the solutions must be shared equitably as global public goods." My second example of being light and calling ourselves to repentance hits a little closer to home. As we've watched the pandemic take a tremendous toll on our nation's people, we've seen it takes its most severe effect on people of color. It has exacerbated our social and economic disparities and inequalities. We've seen that in the availability of health care, the options or lack thereof in school learning capabilities, the unequal overabundance of loss of small businesses in communities of color. We are challenged to take these things into consideration as we go forward to being the light of Christ. Today we have witnessed to our community with our blessing of quilts and pray for the impoverished homes that they will go to through our public school systems. Helen Keller, I think most of you are aware of who Helen Keller was and her lack of sight, but her amazing sight she had even without her physical sight. She once challenged people to go beyond charity and participate in acts of friendship and justice. She said, for this time especially, "Christmas is the harvest time of love. Souls are drawn to other souls. All that we have read and thought and hoped comes to fruition at this happy time. Our spirits are astir. We feel within us a strong desire to serve. A strange subtle force, a new kindness animates man and child. A new spirit is growing in us. No longer are we content to relieve pain, to sweeten sorrow, to give the crust of charity. We dare to give friendship, service, the equal loaf of bread and love." Friendship and justice, the equal loaf of bread and love. Let us pray. God of all, form us into churches beyond borders. When we feel stuck, amplify the prophet's word. When we are distracted by privilege, put us in the wilderness. When we need a new way, dunk us in the river. When we are wrong, move us down the path of truth-telling and repentance. When we need healing, sustain us with your love and hope. When we cannot see beyond ourselves, move us beyond arbitrary borders. Bless us with the Holy Spirit, that the good news may be for us a beginning. In your name we pray. Amen. We rise to sing. This is actually a traditional song, so those that are here, that are over 35 or so, we hope you know this one. This is "Hark the Glad Sound," an obvious Advent song that has a little joy in it. Gather here in the midst of the poinsettias, the quilts, the blue-covered perennials, the Advent wreath. We give you thanks that you are our God, and we are your people. And throughout time, you continue to call your followers, your people, to bring your light to the world, both to share the good news of Jesus in word and also in deed. Thank you for this congregation and its ministries of outreach, such as the Peacemakers and the Food Pantry and other areas that we shine. We pray that in addition to loving each other as members of this parish, we would spread that love out to those outside our circles, that Jesus is your world, and we want to be a part of all of your world. Hear us, O God. God of ever-living creature, you announce the year of your favor for all of creation. Extend your kindness and relief to endangered animals and plants. Strengthen the human beings who rely on the rhythms of nature to make their living. Hear us, O God. God of all peoples and nations, you plant us as your oaks of righteousness and ask us to care for one another. Be present with the leaders of every nation as they govern. Give them a spirit of righteousness that your goodness and mercy is revealed through their actions. Hear us, O God. God of the powerful and helpless, you clothe us with strength when our spirits are weak and weary. Bestow your spirit upon this congregation and empower us to comfort the people who turn to us in times of need. Make your church a place of refuge and healing. Today we especially remember Dan and Faith Nurens, Valerie Rick and Evie Garza, Greg Danielson, and so many other individuals we remember in our hearts that need your healing, that need your care. Truly make us a church, a place of refuge and healing. Hear us, O God. We give you thanks for our children. We pray as a number of them head out for caroling in another hour or so. We pray that the psalms we take out will be received by those of elder ages, that they may hear the good news sung once again. We pray for our safety. We pray that we keep our social distances, that we use our masks appropriately, that we do want to stay safe in this world, and you give us a brain in order to be able to do much of that. So help us to use our brains in so many areas of life. We also pray for the lost youth. We pray that they will continue through this season to be your people. We pray for our world, especially our nation and the divisions in which we live now. Guide us by your grace, guide us by your mercy, to remind us at least in this country we are one nation under God. We're not two nations under God, but rather one. So give us that wisdom we need during this time. Hear us, O God. Draw near to us, O God, and receive our prayers for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who teaches us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now may the Creator of the stars bless your Advent waiting, the long-expected Savior fill you with love, the unexpected Spirit guide your journey now and forever. Amen. Have a few announcements this morning. If you're staying for caroling, I know we're going to be waiting on Dawn to get over from the class, but the pizza should be arriving. And then we'll just have to figure out if we want to do social distancing in there or eat out there. We do need to leave by 12:20. As I told the Brookridge people, we would be there at 12:45. And then that's one thing happening right away. Vicki is still, are you still doing script orders? If anyone would like, Vicki in the back by the soundboard, if you'd like to get a script order, you can get that from her today. And also, if you haven't filled out a pledge card, and you normally maybe don't do that, we find that this year, particularly the Vicki and the finance people, it's difficult to decide what will be our expected income for next year. Because everything was so thrown off with the virus and not being here, different winter Texans not coming. So if you haven't filled one out, maybe you don't normally do that, please consider doing that this year, because that'll help us come up with a more appropriate budget by being able to anticipate that coming in. Last one I have here is Christmas Eve. For now, we're saying we're going to do services at 3 in the afternoon and 6 at night. The 3 o'clock service, again, those that like to sit outside, like at the 9 o'clock service today, we had about 8 people, I think, sitting outside with the speaker. So that'll be available at 3, and then at 6 we're indoors. With all the changes and things, we will not be lighting candles this year, just passing and touching and stuff. I didn't mention it to the overabundance of traditional folks at 9, but one option is to bring your cell phone, and like they do at concerts, to turn the flashlight on or whatever at that time in the candle lighting. Other announcements that anyone needs to make this morning? It's wonderful to see all of you. John, do you feel like a person to put the candles out as we sing? Are you up for that? With the candle lighter piece. We can have you do that. And the rest of us will rise to sing the song.
Prepare the way of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And we will.